Hello viewers, in my last lecture on monosaccharides, I had discussed stereochemistry of monosaccharides, that is the occurrence of enantiomers, diastereomers and epimers. We know enantiomers are non-superimposable mirror images of each other and they are optically active. For example, D-glucose and L-glucose. Whereas when we talk of diastereomers, they are not superimposable mirror images of each other. That is, they differ in configuration either at one or more chiral carbons. That is, they do not differ in configuration at each chiral carbon. And for this, we had discussed the examples of D-glucose and D-L-trose. When I mean D here, what I mean is D-configuration. That is OH on the highest numbered carbon is on the right-hand side. Then we had discussed another term, which was epimers. Epimers are subunit of diastereomers. That is, they are stereoisomers which differ in configuration only at one chiral carbon. And for this, we know the examples are glucose and mannose. That is, D-glucose and D-mannose are C2 epimers. That is, they differ in configuration at C2 carbon. Then we discussed that glucose has an aldehyde group as well as 5 hydroxyl groups in it. So it has a tendency to undergo internal reaction between a CHO group and a OH group, resulting in cyclic structure which is known as hemiacetal, or this is also known as enomers. The two structures will result which are known as enomers. And these enomers differ in configuration at C1 in case of glucose, and they will differ in configuration at C2 in case of fructose. So that means now they are special type of epimers which result due to cyclization of glucose or cyclization of fructose. That is, we can say in a broader term, cyclization of monosaccharides or monosaccharides which can be aldohexoses or ketohexoses. Now, in today's lecture, I shall be discussing the properties of monosaccharides further. In this, I'll be taking an example of glucose. And we know glucose is an important monosaccharide and it has 6 carbons and an aldehyde group. And its molecular formula is C6H12O6. Since its molecular formula is C6H6O6, that is, it has 6 carbons along with an aldehyde group, it is known as aldohexose. And since glucose is dextrorotatory, that is, it rotates the path of plane polarized light in right-hand direction, it is also known as dextrose. Along with glucose, other common monosaccharides that are of importance are galactose. Galactose forms the part of sugar found in milk. And we also have fructose. Fructose is found in fruits. Now, what is the relationship between glucose, galactose and fructose? 3 of them have the same molecular formula, which is C6H12O6, but they have different physical, chemical or biological activities. So we say they are isomers. So what is the relationship between fructose and glucose and galactose? So when we talk of the relationship between fructose and glucose and galactose, what we find that fructose is a structural isomer of glucose and galactose. And that it is a functional isomer. That is, the functional group in fructose is keto, whereas that in glucose and galactose, it is an aldehyde group. So their properties will be different. So if you can see on your screens the structure of fructose, and what we find in fructose, the functional group is carbonyl group, which is a keto group. Whereas in case of glucose and galactose, this functional group is CHO. So what do we say? We say fructose is a functional isomer of glucose and galactose. And then you can observe that we've written D, capital D fructose, capital D glucose, and capital D galactose. What does this capital D indicate? It indicates that the OH on the highest numbered asymmetric carbon is on the right hand side in all the three structures which you can see on your screens. And when we compare the structure of glucose with galactose, we find that both of them have the same functional group, that is aldehyde group. But where do they differ? They differ in the orientation of the OH group on the second carbon, that is the first chiral carbon. So what we find in glucose, this OH is on the right hand side. This OH is on the right hand side, whereas in case of galactose, I was thinking of glucose and mannose, but what you can see on your screens is the structure of glucose and galactose. And when we talk of glucose and galactose, they are C4 epimers, that is, they differ in configuration at the fourth carbon. So we say that they are C4 epimers. So now when I'm talking of glucose and fructose, what do I mean by saying that their properties are different? See, what we mean here is that supposing we carry out the reduction of glucose with hydrogen in presence of sodium, or with of fructose with hydrogen in presence of sodium. In case of glucose, we will get sorbitol. Whereas when we talk of fructose, I'll be discussing these properties in this in detail. Fructose will give us two diastereomers, that is D-mannitol and D-sorbitol. So this is how the properties of glucose and fructose will differ. Whereas when we talk of galactose and glucose, what we find, as you can see, that these are examples of epimers, that is, they differ in configuration at fourth carbon, that is, in glucose the OH is on the right hand side, whereas in galactose this OH is on the left hand side. So they are examples of diastereomers, or to be more precise, they are examples of epimers, since they are differing in configuration at this chiral carbon. And when they are differing at configuration at third chiral carbon, what we find is this difference in configuration plays a very important role in biology. That is, the enzymes can differentiate between glucose and galactose on the basis of the configuration at this third asymmetric carbon. So this is again what I have shown here on the screens, that the configuration at the third carbon is different. In glucose, the OH is on the right hand side, whereas in galactose, the OH is on the left hand side. And D, of course, you know that capital D is indicating that in glucose as well as in galactose, the OH is on the right hand side at the highest numbered asymmetric carbon. So now let us discuss the properties of glucose in this lecture, and in the oncoming lectures we shall be discussing the properties of fructose as well as galactose, and how do they differ from each other. So we know that glucose was first isolated from raisins by Andreas Markgraf. He was a German chemist and he isolated it from raisins in 1747. Then another chemist, that is Jean-Baptiste Dumas, in 1838 coined the word glucose. So what is now glucose? If we talk of where is glucose synthesized in animals and where is it found in plants, we know glucose is synthesized in liver and kidneys of animals, and in plants it is found in sweet fruits like grapes, raisins, and it is also found in different parts of plants, because you know glucose is the first carbohydrate which is synthesized by plants by the process of photosynthesis. That is, carbon dioxide reacts with water in presence of sunlight and chlorophyll to give us glucose. That means in this case we are storing energy in form of glucose, which is used by plants, and then animals consume these plants, and therefore we say carbohydrates are source of energy. And we also know that glucose is an essential constituent of human blood, and since it is essential constituent of human blood, glucose is also known as blood sugar. Now I have shown on the screens, you can see the structure of D-glucose. Why are we stressing on structure of D-glucose? Because D-glucose is the sugar which occurs naturally, that is, it occurs in nature. L-glucose we synthesize in the laboratory. So as you can see, this glucose molecule has 6 carbons in it, so it is known as an hexose, and since it has an aldehyde group, it is known as aldohexose. And the configuration, the alphabet D here, indicates that the OH is on the right hand side at the highest numbered asymmetric carbon. So in this case we have the asymmetric carbons are 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and 5th. So at the 5th carbon, the OH is on the right hand side, so glucose is given configuration capital D. If this OH was on the left hand side, it would have been assigned configuration capital L. So if we talk of the physical properties of glucose, we know, as you've seen, that glucose is colorless in nature. Then colorless, it is sweet crystalline compound and it has a melting point on 419 Kelvin. It is readily soluble in water and acetic acid, and sparingly soluble in alcohol and insoluble in ether. It is soluble in water and acetic acid because it forms intermolecular hydrogen bonding with them, whereas ether is nonpolar, so this molecule, that is sugars, are not soluble in ether, and it forms a monohydrate when we crystallize it from water. It forms a monohydrate, and that monohydrate has a melting point of 391 Kelvin. And as I've already said, that the aqueous solution of glucose is dextrorotatory. That is, it will change the path of plane polarized light, and it will rotate it in right hand direction. Hence, it is dextrorotatory. And when we compare the sweetness of this glucose to sucrose, please remember, is the table sugar, then what we find that glucose is about 75% as sweet as sugarcane, and that means it is less sweeter than sucrose, and sucrose is the table sugar. Now we go on to the chemical properties of glucose, and now when we have to talk of chemical properties of glucose, you have to see that in glucose the primary group, functional group here, is the aldehyde group, that is the CHO group, and then it has 5 hydroxyl groups. That means it will show us the properties of the aldehyde group as well as the 5 hydroxyl groups. And out of these 5 hydroxyl groups, 4 are secondary and 1 is a primary hydroxyl group. So let us see. So that means since it has an aldehyde group, and this aldehyde group is a primary group, so that means glucose will give us all those reactions which aldehydes and ketones give us. And you are very familiar with the properties of aldehydes and ketones, that the reactions of the carbonyl group are nucleophilic addition reactions. So what I mean by saying nucleophilic addition reactions, that is this carbon will have a partial positive charge on it, and oxygen has a partial negative charge on it, since there is a bond between this carbon and oxygen, and the bond is double bond. That means this carbon is sp2 hybridized, and this carbon has a partial positive charge on it, therefore it is electrophilic in nature. Now it will react with HCN, and we know that in HCN H will has a positive charge and CN has a negative charge. So what happens in the first step, that this CN, which is acting as a nucleophile, it will make a bond with this carbon here. So when it forms a bond with this carbon, what we find that this group initially here had planar geometry, but now when the reaction takes place, this carbon here will become sp3 hybridized. As you can see here, it is attached to 4 groups by 4 single bonds. That means the orientation of the carbon will change, that is the structure will change here. And in such a case, what we are generating here is a chiral carbon here. This carbon is chiral carbon. And the second thing that you have to notice here is that in the original compound we had 6 carbons, whereas if we look into this molecule, what we find, which is an example of cyanohydrin, that this has 7 carbons in it. So this is a step up reaction, which I have discussed earlier on also in my previous lecture, and which I'll be discussing again in detail, that this is the first step in Fischer-Kilianni synthesis. And supposing now I talk of arabinose, and I say arabinose, you know, is a 5 carbon sugar and it has an aldehyde group. Now when we bring about the reaction of arabinose with HCN, we carry out the hydrolysis and the reduction, we will get 2 diastereomers, that is we will get glucose and mannose. So this is how we can bring about the reaction. So this reaction is very, very important with HCN, because in this we are stepping up, that is we are adding 1 carbon to the chain, and in the process we are also generating a chiral carbon, as a result of which we will get diastereomeric, or we will get epimers. That is, if we start from arabinose, carry out the reaction with HCN followed by hydrolysis and then reduction with the hydrogen in presence of palladium and BaSO4, we will get a mixture of D-glucose and D-mannose. Now this reaction again is an example, special example of addition reaction, which is known as condensation reaction. Why is this known as condensation reaction? Because in this case what we find, a water molecule is being eliminated, and the reaction, the bond, a double bond is being formed between a carbon and an NOH group. So when a reaction of glucose or any aldohexime is carried out with hydroxyl amine, we get, when we are carrying out the reaction with glucose, we get glucose monooxime, that is we are getting 1 group here. And the thing to be noticed here is that all other groups, the hydroxyl groups, are not taking part in the reaction. It is only the aldehyde group which is taking part in the reaction. Now, a very, very important reaction, and which is generally asked in the exams, that is, give the mechanism of formation of ozazone. Right? So, when they ask you, give the mechanism of preparation of ozazone or formation of ozazone, what you have to remember, that is, you are carrying out the reaction of glucose with phenyl hydrazine. Now, what is phenyl hydrazine? Hydrazine is NH2, and when we replace one hydrogen of hydrazine with phenyl group, it becomes phenyl hydrazine. And here I have shown you the overall reaction of interaction between D-glucose and phenyl hydrazine, and what we find that one molecule of D-glucose reacts with three molecules of phenyl hydrazine to give us the ozazone of D-glucose, and in the process one molecule of aniline, one molecule of ammonia and two molecules of hydrogen are liberated. Now, the thing to be noticed here is that we can also say that when glucose is treated with excess of phenylhydrazine. So, why do we say excess of phenylhydrazine here? Because one molecule of glucose is reacting with three molecules of phenylhydrazine. So, we say we are using three molecules of phenylhydrazine. And what you have to notice here, that in the previous reactions that we have discussed till now, that is the reaction with HCN and hydroxylamine, only the CHO group was taking part. Whereas when we carry out the reaction with phenyl hydrazine, we are carrying out the reaction. In this case, two carbons are taking part in the reaction. That is the first carbon, which is the aldehyde group, and the second carbon, which is having a hydroxyl group in it. The third, fourth, fifth and sixth carbon do not take part in the reaction. So, the reaction will only take place at these positions. So, what happens in this case is that first molecule of phenyl hydrazine reacts, glucose reacts with phenyl hydrazine to form glucose phenyl hydrazone. And in the next step, the second molecule of phenyl hydrazine oxidizes second carbon atom to form a keto group. Now, this keto group undergoes a rearrangement. When it reacts with the second molecule of phenyl hydrazine, it will be the alcoholic group, that is at the second carbon, will be oxidized to a keto group, and here a rearrangement reaction takes place. And then in the last step, again this will react with phenyl hydrazine to form the final product. I will be discussing the mechanism of this reaction in my next lecture. And for this lecture, I had followed the examples, I had followed the references, the books of Carey Francis, McMurray Joan, Wade and Claydon. These books are quite useful when you're studying carbohydrates. Thank you.